Hello and welcome back to the second game of the first round of the Legends and Minions tournament, where the pros are coaching the noobs and hilarity may or may not ensue. I offer no guarantees. All right, we are about to head into Blodir versus Mephi. This is on Twin Rivers once again. We will see the pros control K-ing their ACUs on start. All right, we don't need any more introduction. Let's head on in. And let's go. All right, so we have got Blodir up in the top this time, and Mephi, let's remember that so we know which is which. Let's go introduce Mephi's crew. We have got our master, who is Cyber, and he's going to throw down his first land factory, getting adjacency on that mass extractor. A single power generator is in the works before he grabs those core mixes. It's your funeral is also going to go Cybern. Are we going to see more Corsairs? Oh, that's going to be interesting if we do. We are going to get our first land factory down. We're getting adjacency as well on a single mix. And we can see a lot of plans for power in the immediate future and not a lot of mix building. We've got everywhere 116. He's going to go Aeon. He's got his land factory down. He is going to get an air factory after that, but he needs a bunch of power to do so. So we can see all of those power generators planned. All right, Blodir's guys up the top here. We have got Pekoz. He is going to go UEF. He's got a single land factory, and he's going to not build any power generators before rushing that hydro. Oh, actually, he is going to start building that factory before the hydro is completed. That was not the best idea, and that has been corrected, which is a nice either pickup there from Pekoz or from the pro that is watching him. So Blodir might have just yelled at him and said, don't do that, you will stall. All right, Hershey is over here. He's going to throw down a stack of power generators so that he can get a air factory up and running and get himself across to the mainland. And then last but not least, we have got Ish, who is 1600. We've got two 1600s. This is only just a little bit lower than the pros that they're supposedly being coached by. This is a bit dodgy. Why are we letting the virtually pro players, well, pro compared to me, okay, maybe they're not really pros, but really good players, into the noob teams? Anyway, we've got a air factory down for the Aeon player. That is Ish. He's going to throw down a bunch of power generators to be able to get what he needs out of that factory. Got a couple of early scouts heading up into the middle here just to try and spot any forward movement, and those will also catch any bombers coming directly from the other side, so you will pick those guys up on radar if there was a bomber. But so far, not so much in the way of bombing action. In fact, if there was any bombing action, it would be coming across from the islands, because these guys are going to be the ones focusing on air. We are definitely going to be seeing land from these guys. All right, our master has got two land factories completed. He's working on a third. He's got his engineers out on expansion duty. Well, actually, it looks like the first order of the day is reclaim, but I'm not really sure that the extra time to walk all the way across to the center island is really worth it. There's only 500 or so mass in that, whereas he could pick up all of these rocks here in a much shorter time. So overall, probably slightly less mass, but he would have it a lot faster, so that probably makes it a lot more valuable. And what is this? This is a very, very cheeky, very, very early drop here. It has been spotted, though. How did that get spotted? There must be the scouts going overhead. Of course it is. That is going to start putting down a land factory, and this could be a very, very difficult foothold for these guys to get rid of. If they can get established there, if Hershey is, hang on, is that? No, that's Ish. Hershey is beside him in the slightly different orange color. If Ish can get established there, that is going to be problematic. He's already got 1.5 land factories up and running. He's going to have a bunch of spam pretty soon. But the Mantis are on the case. If those Mantis can get in and deal to it before too many Auroras pop out, then it will be a win for Ish. But that Aurora, oh, terrible stuff. It just ran straight out into the Mantis. That is terrible play. It didn't kite them. It should have sat back and used the range on that Aurora to take out those Mantis. But as it stands, the engineers are going to go down. Oh, I don't know if this is going to work. There's a big stream of Mantis coming out from the base of our master here. If he directs even a fraction of those over this way, it is going to be lights out for this forward position. Whoop, there we go. This is much better play from Ish. He's hiding that Aurora behind the factory. The factory is tanking the damage, and those Auroras using the range to take out those Tech 1 units. So a bit of micro here from Ish is starting to make itself felt, and that could be the difference between a win and a loss here for these guys. So that is maybe Blodir's cunning plan, that he is going to get a drop early on to this very, very forward position. Of course, if it fails, if for some reason this forward position does get lost, it is going to put the North team at a big disadvantage, because that player will be completely ejected from the island. He doesn't have a backup base up this way where it's a little bit safer. And it's starting to look a little bit dicey. We've got a couple of Auroras here. They're going to be able to whittle away at those Mantis, but we're starting to see just too many units and even an ACU for good measure. This guy is going to seal the deal. That is going to make Ish regret, well, probably Blodir regret, trying to take a position so far forward. That has pretty much been lost now. So that was a big investment in resources at a very early stage, which unfortunately is just going to turn into reclaim for Blodir's team. In fact, our master, are any of the guys Aeon on his team? We've got Cybran, and we do have Aeon too. He already has access to Aeon tech, but if he didn't, it would have been a good opportunity to snaffle one of those factories and just give himself a little bit of extra technology. Perhaps, well, I don't know, what would you do with Aeon on this? Mercy's probably not going to play out too well, because there's a whole stack of air, and there probably will be through the whole game. You could potentially do a Harb Rush. Those guys are pretty fast and could cause problems. But in the confines of the plateau back here and around the back of these bases, maybe not the most effective. So we can understand why he's not trying to snaffle that. It's much more important to him to grab this reclaim and grab those mixes. All right, we can see he's moving on up, starting to fight a little bit with the unit coming down from Pekoz. Badly outnumbered there, Pekoz losing the tanks that he did have. And it looks about even down in the south here. So we can see there is probably about 10 or so Tech 1 units for each of them. But a little bit of air support as well. Actually, it's your funeral doing a very nice job of spamming interceptors. He's got a couple of bombers as well, just for good measure. So it's your funeral pretty well in air control right now. We've got a potential engagement brewing between these two guys. It looks like roughly even numbers, but our master just needed to keep moving. If he can get back up there, he actually is going to have a little bit of an advantage, because he's got nice fast Mantis compared to the slightly slower Strikers. Those Mantis will be able to get up into the back of the base and cause all sorts of trouble. And if they can run into a stream of Tech 1 units, they should be able to take them out one by one pretty effectively. So this is an opportunity here for our master to actually do some eco damage and eliminate some of those mixes. The Tech 2 transport is online now for It's Your Funeral, so he's got his ACU onto the mainland. That is going to make this position very difficult to attack with the Tech 1 armies that are slowly dribbling down this way, although they're mostly just trying to deal with these raids from our master. These very, very serious and, well, kind of effective raids. There's a mix down so far, another mix. Reasonably effective, it's just doing a little bit of damage. Well, actually, that wasn't a mix, it was another tank. But if he moves that artillery, he will be able to take out that mix. He just has to remember to do so. All right, we can even see some swift winds out from everywhere. So that's going to give them a bunch of air power. So a real focus from the south, from Mephi's anus, on air power. So yeah, who would have thought that Mephi's anus would make air? Ooh, I thought we could probably have guessed that. Okay, so we've got swift winds out. We have got a bunch of Tech 1 spam rolling across the country. Like, look at this, just getting all into the back of everything, just causing an absolute nuisance, just roving around, being a pain. That is fantastic. That is Mephi's instruction doing a lot better. Typically, I would have thought Blodir would be very, very good at getting his guys into the back there, but maybe he's just getting frustrated at their noobness and forgetting to give them real instruction. We've even got guys back here. So very, very nice raiding so far, and not a lot of counter raiding at all. Let's check in with the island up here. So Ish, I think, is probably still suffering a little bit from the lack of mass, or the mass that he lost and donated over to our master over here, who's actually on upgrade. Has he got the notify on? No. Oh, yes, he does. But I can't read that, but I can see that it is gun. Alright, so Ish looks to be focusing more on eco, which is not surprising given that Blodir is a bit of an eco whore, so he will be focusing his minions on collecting economy for him so he can be an evil overlord of economy. We have got our Tech 2 factory up over this way, so we're starting to produce, is that Swift Winds coming out of that factory, trying to get some semblance of air control back, but at this point it's going to be pretty difficult. There's a good swarm of, what is that, must be like 35 interceptors plus a few Swift Winds of their own down in the south there. A pretty serious engagement happening here. The numbers are looking pretty even, so all that is going to do, I would suggest, is leave a bunch of reclaim for Pecos to pick up. You'll have to excuse the muted bits. Just got a little bit of a cough, which we'll have to deal with. All right, so we've got a pretty substantial number of T1 units left here for Pecos. He's going to start bringing them down and ripping through that Tech 1 army that our master has got there. The ACU, though, where is that ACU? They're hugging the rock. That ACU may need to come into play to try and preserve the front lines here for Mephi's team, because at the moment it looks like they're probably going to collapse. There's no point defense in place. There's a bit of a wall, but that wall is not going to do particularly well. And we can see the transport there gifted over to everywhere, so he can bring his ACU over to here as well. And we can definitely do with another ACU right now, because they are just about out of Tech 1 units. This is not going too well at all. Pecos is going to be able to punch right through. The only thing is that he does have to divert some of his units to deal with these annoying raids that are just keeping these mexes free. Alright, we can see Ish finally making his way over to the mainland. He starts immediately with a Tech 1 land factory so that he can start spamming as well, because that's what this team desperately needs, more spam on the ground. It looks like our master is actually managing to catch some engineers out, taking out a few more mixes on their way through. Very mobile, very nice to see. And even a couple of gunships. We've got some Spectres out from everywhere. He's going to make use of that Tech 2 air factory. Those guys are going to come in and just start laying down fire. There's not a lot of ground-based AA for Pecos right now. We can see just a little bit of Tech 1 mobile AA in the mix, but not a heck of a lot. These guys are just going to have to... Well, actually, the balance is definitely shifting right now with the combined army from our master plus the ACU. That is actually ripping a new one in Pecos's army, and if Pecos doesn't get a whole lot of support really soon, he's going to find himself dying to these guys down here. That would be very, very bad for Blodir's team, because then it would be 3 versus 2, but not only that, it would be 3 with a 90% map control and 2 with the remainder. We do have a very, very nice little pack of Swift Winds there, though. Those guys are doing a fantastic job of cleaning up the bombers and gunships that are annoying them. The Tech 1 interceptor is still just hovering around, but they're going to pretty quickly find themselves outclassed by those Swift Winds. We can see a little bit more of a static game developing over on the left here. We've got a couple of Tech 2 point defense going down from everywhere. Not quite sure what the point of guarding this little mountain is, but maybe the pro has a plan? Hard to say. Ish is managing to start getting some decent spam numbers together. We've got a bunch of Auroras rolling down. He needs to make sure he's got radar coverage though, and I'm not seeing many scouts. There's one scout in the mix there. Very, very little radar coverage though. Those Auroras definitely need their radars so that they can keep an eye on what their gun can shoot, since they've got more main cannon range than they've got vision range. We've got some point defense going down to try and hold this line. Unfortunately, coming under fire from the Auroras already. He needs to back those Auroras up though, and ouch, they are taking fire from those Oblivion turrets. Those turrets ripping those paper Auroras apart. The lower HP on those guys not lasting at all when up against that. But at least it is taking a little bit of pressure off of Pakoz now, so there's not as many T1 units. A whole bunch of them have been brought back to defend against this threat from Ish, and that means that Pakoz has now got a little bit of breathing room to get enough numbers up, maybe get a tech upgrade. Has he got any tech upgrades going on? Not seeing much on the front line. Let's have a quick look back here. Alright, so we do have our Tech 2 Land HQ starting to pop pillars out. How far are the pillars getting? There's one pillar there, there's a flak. So just about starting to make their way to the front lines. Unfortunately, throwing away his Tech 1 army on this assault here. There are Oblivion turrets down here as well. Those guys are getting absolutely hammered by the Rhinos, the ACUs, the Oblivions. There is way too much there for that Tech 1 army to push through, and they are just being converted into a reclaim. Got a bit of a scouting run going across there from Hershey. That is nice to see. Scouting does indeed save lives. We've got Tech 2 power. We have got a Tech 2 air HQ still looking away. Hershey has got a lot of assistance on this, producing that air force that he wants. He's still got his ACU back on the mainland though. In fact, that scouting run was for a bit of an attack because he was thinking about mercying an ACU. How vulnerable are these guys to air right now? Well, there's a lot of interceptors there, all out of fuel though, so not the most effective, but you still can't fly mercies through a crowd of interceptors. We have got a little bit of ground-based AA. We've got one flak here. A couple of T1 static AAs would be very, very handy right about now to keep those ACUs safe from mercies. What is the plan for those mercies? He's got five so far. Is he still producing them? Yes, he is. He's going to have a very, very tough time getting through this flak. All of the ACUs are in this tight little bunch here. Perhaps It's Your Funeral would be vulnerable. The distance from that flak means that the bombs would ignite about here, or detonate about here. That probably would give them an opening. If they could come in here, that probably would be a free hit on It's Your Funeral. So how many mercies did he put together? It looks like 5, 6, 7 mercies. He's going to need to bring those swift winds to bear to take out this cloud of Tech 1 interceptors while he can. There is a shield generator going down as well. That's going to be up very, very shortly. That's going to absorb a lot of extra damage from those mercies. I think Hershey might be just a little bit too late to be able to do what he wants. In fact, those interceptors starting to waft towards those mercies, and ouch, they are going to go down. That is very, very badly timed. He actually herded the crowd of interceptors into the mercies, which I think is probably the exact opposite of what Blodir had planned. So that is very unfortunate indeed. He's got a ton of scouts though. If only scouts could kill ACUs. Things are looking reasonably static down here on the right hand side of the mainland. These guys sitting under shields. They're throwing down some T1 static AA just for good measure as well against any more potential mercies, but I'm pretty sure that won't be happening again after the absolutely miserable fail that was that snipe attempt. We've got a whole stack more scouts rolling on, and they should get a little bit of vision over the top there. They're going to see that there is tactical missile defense. They're potentially going to see, let's see, there is no T3 upgrade happening just yet, I don't believe. We've got Ah, here we are. We are about 25% of the way towards that T3 air. And how we checking in up here? We've got still producing units out of that air HQ. And Hershey is now switching up to his T3. So we're starting to see at 17 minutes that shift and these guys thinking about Tech 3 air. We've got a couple of... what? We've got bricks, I think, rolling on in on an Aeon gifted transport. That is fine. You can do that. Those bricks are going to absolutely rip through all of this T1. But these guys, what are you doing? There is... everywhere has the ability to put down a volcano right now in a very short amount of time, and that will ward away all of these tech missiles, all these mobile missiles. But unfortunately, he's not actually doing that. He's just going to walk his ACU around and continue to take fire from the mobile missile launchers. What is going on? This is ridiculous play. He needs to be instructed. He needs to be yelled at a little bit by his pro. So Mephi, you need to be yelling it everywhere. Build a single volcano in there to keep that forward base alive. We can see we're starting to get some more bricks pouring out of the back here. We are on Tech 3 land. We've got a couple of trebuchets out, but not doing a heck of a lot of good right back here. He probably wants to pick those guys up with the transport. Is that what the transport is for? Yes, that is what the transport is for. That is probably going to bring them up to the front line. Those trebuchets, they will be able to deal with these mobile missiles. But everywhere, still not building a single volcano. Unfortunate, unfortunate move. Alright, so we've got the T3 artillery rolling on up, or transporting on up, to deal with assault here. This assault, there is a large cloud of T1 just sitting around doing absolutely nothing, and everything is looking pretty static on this side as well, although it is all T1 save these Oblivion turrets. That would mean that just a couple of bricks or Percivals or something heavy would actually be able to slowly make their way through all of that. Alright, we've got these two bricks on in here, and Pekoz is actually going to come and overcharge them and keep those guys apart. Oh, we got one overcharge in, but it wasn't enough area of effect to take both of them out. So we'll take a second overcharge, but look how much damage that has done on the ACU from just those two bricks. So we're looking at still a very static game in the center. Oh, we do have a tech missile launcher. That is a nice touch. It has one kill on it. What is that going for? Are there tech 2 mixes to take out? Well, no, it doesn't look like there's much in the way of tech 2 mixes. What is this? More mercies. Oh dear. A little bit of resource wasted on that, but we are starting to see some tech 3 air in the way of ASF across the map now. Do we have that Tech 3 air out? Well, we've got it paused because not enough power. That's why. We've got a quantum reactor just about ready to go. Once that's come online, it will be able to start feeding enough to that air factory to produce some ASF. Okay, interestingly, it looks like these trebuchets are not dealing with the mobile missile. So, oh, finally, a volcano does go down here from everywhere, but not after he lost most of that forward position, the shield, and all of the Oblivion turrets are all gone completely needlessly. It doesn't take more than a couple of volcanoes to hold back a decent swarm of mobile missile launchers. They are flapjacks, so not the fastest rate of fire either. Alright, we are getting a good cloud of ASF now, so it looks like Hershey is actually doing a really nice job of getting that T3 air up and on the field, much more than everywhere has managed to get so far. He has switched his T3 air factory online now, but he is at a little bit of a disadvantage. The numbers are definitely in Hershey's favor. Alright, it looks like finally... oh no, I thought those trebuchets might have finally been firing at these clumped up missile launchers. But no, and a ping goes down. Please, please deal with those. Just a couple of trebuchet shots will do it. But no, you're just wasting them into the shields over here. Please just take those guys. Okay, it looks like the response to the ping is to send Mantis. Mantis of all things against those guys. Oh, okay, I'm getting frustrated just watching this. I hate to think what Mephi is doing right now. We should probably try and get a picture of Mephi after this and see how much hair he has got left, because it's probably not going to be too much. The Mantis sort of half-assedly chasing away those flapjacks, managing to take out a few of them with the sporadic trebuchet fire, but I think it was just an accident that some of those guys got killed. I don't think that they have managed to very effectively deal with those. And what have we got? We've got torpedo bombers out because our master is throwing Navy into the water. Wow. That could be huge if they got to T2. If they managed to get some T2 Navy up, especially if they were using the UEF tech and getting the T2 cruisers for UEF with those TAC missile launchers, well, cruise missiles, whatever you want to call them, they would be very, very good at breaking this entire position up here and taking out all of that eco, which is now at T3s. So we've got three T3 mixes for Ish. How's Hershey going? He is focusing a little bit more on the power side of things. He's still sitting on all Tech 2 mass extractors, but a couple of UEF cruisers in there would take out the air and it would take out all of this base in a reasonably short amount of time. But unfortunately, they are losing all of that to the torpedo bombers because Hershey still actually has a pretty good handle on air control. We can see the ASF cruising around, keeping those torpedo bombers safe. And we've also got a bunch of Swift Winds as backup. Well, actually, ASF down here, it doesn't even need any assistance. The torpedo bombers are fine all by themselves. Alright, the trebuchets. How many trebuchets have we got now? We've got 3, 5, 6, one rolling up. Finally starting to get enough happening to push back the cause, and it's actually putting a bit of pressure on this base. These shields are going to go down reasonably soon, and that'll leave it open to being destroyed by the trebuchets. The most of the army, though, for Pekoz is unfortunately Tech 1. Ouch. There is not even much of a Tech 2 spam going on. There's a couple of pillars down here, but they are taking a lot of fire from those trebuchets. Looks like all of the T3 investment is going into response demolishers to try and assault this position back, but you're going to have a bad time trying to bring 3 or 4 or 5 demolishers up against a shielded position. Well, slightly shielded position, I suppose you could say, full of demolishers as well. It all depends on if they can focus fire, because it looks like our master's probably not focusing his fire particularly well. He's mostly been battering on these shields up the front here. If that gives the demolishers here a chance to take out these trebuchets, well, that could just turn it a little bit. But that's not the most interesting thing that we just saw on screen. This is the most interesting. Wait a minute. Why are you building 2 experimentals? You built a fifth of a megalith before Mephi told you, don't be stupid, build a monkey, it's cheaper. And so now they switch to monkey and they're not reclaiming the megalith. I hope these guys are just overflowing resources to not bother reclaiming. What? No, mine is 92 mass, but it's your funeral. And then everywhere is, well, he's actually got some mass in the tank, so that is pretty good for him. But he needs to focus all of that resource into getting that monkey lord finished, although he may not need it. What the real risk, I think, at the moment is from the air, because Hershey's just done such a fantastic job of getting the T3 air up online in big numbers. He has got really good control, and he could actually use strap bombers right now. There are a few SAMs floating around that can be a problem for those strap bombers, but probably back here there's not a lot. There's some Tech 1 anti-air. Yeah, there's not a lot else, so he could come back, he could take out the T3 HQs, he could take out the mass extractors, he could do a lot of damage. But the reason they actually need to get that finished is because, whoa, Ish has finished a Galactic Colossus. So that is where all the mass from those T3 mixes has been going. It hasn't gone into units. We can see he's only got a few dozen units there compared to all the spam that these other guys have put together. But there is a GC. Now let's just have a quick look from the Southern team's perspective. And they have just spotted that. There's no ping yet. There would be some big, big yelling going on. And and in order, reclaim. Do not try and build that monkey lord. Build it back in your base and just reclaim all of that mass. I don't think they've got the time to do it though. They are going to go down very, very quickly. And it looks like, is one person reclaiming, one person building? Oh, I think that is the case. Oh, that's absolutely terrible stuff. So one team reclaiming, one player building the monkey lord. So they've got, it was about a third to a half of a monkey lord and a fifth of a megalith, and they are just going completely to waste. And that means that there is absolutely nothing left for these guys to deal with that GC. So a surprise GC at 26 minutes from ish is going to bring these guys down. Well, actually, look at the number of ASF. I'm a little bit surprised actually at the number of ASF that Evilware has managed to put together. He looks like he's trying to force an air engagement, but I don't know what good that will do at this point, unless he's got a whole lot of gunships to take out that GC. He really can't make use of any air control that he wins right now. So GC just continuing to wander on through. Oh, let's jump back to observer mode so we can see what is going on with it. It is not at a single veterancy level yet, but that cannot be far away because it is running into a pack of T2 and T3. Well, actually, T1 and a bit of T3. There's loyalists. If the loyalists can get in there and stun it, there we go. That is fantastic work. We need more loyalists to come in and stun. This GC is actually at risk right now, especially if those loyalists, it might even be worth getting in there and just hug it with those loyalists. Hug the GC and stun it. There we go. Stun. Very, very nice. They are actually going to be able to take down that Galactic Colossus. That is amazing to see. That is very, very well played by Mephi's anus. Wowzers. They have managed to take it down, and that gives them a huge stack of reclaim. It did cost them this forward position, but that was very, very nicely dealt with. There are still a few bricks left to come in and deal with the harbingers. They should be able to do that no problem, and that is actually going to cost ish very, very dearly. Blodir will be very sad right now that he lost that GC. We just need some engineers to roll on in, and there is a whopping 22k mass plus all the bricks lying around, so we could be approaching about 30,000 mass now on the field for these guys to pick up and turn into an experimental. So they'll be able to grab a monkey lord pretty quickly. Have we got it under construction? Well, only just. We've even got some hives here to help, but so far probably not enough resource to make that happen. Whoa, actually, what overflowing mass. There we go. Finally, the engineers are assisting the hive, and they're, oh my god. Okay, just get the monkey lord built, please. Okay, we've even got some corsairs for good measure just rolling around taking out those extraordinarily annoying flapjacks. In fact, I wouldn't be surprised if those are still the same flapjacks that we saw 10 minutes ago attacking this fire base. They are still rocking around, still causing trouble. Let's have a look at the air game, because I thought it wasn't going to be necessary, but it is actually going to be a little bit longer. We're at 47 ASF for everywhere, and then let's jump across to Hershey, who has got 42, so it is actually pretty even, a slight advantage in numerical points to everywhere. Alright, what is Ish going to do in response? Well, it looks like he is so sad about losing that GC that he's just going to sit there and sulk. If we zoom in far enough, can we see a little sad face? Yeah, he looks pretty sad. He looks depressed. So, we've got no experimental coming up from the north thing, from Blodir's minions. I don't think so. No, it doesn't look like that's happening. They're continually getting raided, though, which is problematic. Ish is now on full T3 economy. He has now decided to go up to Tech 3 Air, so he is going to get some options there. What is he going to do? Is he maybe going to produce ASF and try and wrestle back that air control, which will let him use restorers, potentially, to deal out a bit of damage? Although, well, there's not a lot of ground-based AA on the south for Mephi's team, so a bunch of restorers probably could do a reasonable amount of damage if they could get that air control back. We've got the spider. It should... Whoa! Is it already completed? No. Oh. Okay, so they've changed their mind again on what to build. So they've reclaimed the spider and instead building a megalith. That's got to be the case, isn't it? I don't see a spider. Oh, it's ridiculous. Make up your mind, people. So we're actually going for a megalith now, which will have that increased HP and increased range on those main guns. That megalith should be able to clear out this mainland because I'm not spotting anything under construction that is sufficiently going to be able to tackle it. Oh, here we go. There is a GC. It is about 1/5 completed though. The megalith with a bit of support, a few bricks alongside it, that'll have no trouble at wiping that GC aside though and clearing out this mainland. All right, we are getting a few gunships on. No, what is this? Another megalith. What? We've got a megalith just sitting around. I think they've forgotten to move it after it's been built. Surely that is the case. Oh, and another megalith. What is going on? It is megalith spam time. So we're going to have at least two and maybe a third megalith on the mainland for Mephi's team. How is Blodir going to cope with this? Blodir is going to get absolutely shafted, I think, on his pro coach duties by Mephi's Janus. All right, let's see how those ASF numbers are going. We are looking at 63. And why are these guys not forcing an engagement? Well, they're just trying to build up numbers, so they're exactly identical right now. There are a few Swift ones as well, but what is Ish doing with his factory? Ah, he is producing ASF. So that is the plan from Blodir's team, to try and get that air superiority back and be able to cause some damage. If they can get air superiority, they can attack those megaliths with gunships. That will be reasonably effective. If they can get the gunship numbers that they need, they should be able to pump the T2 gunships out of those highly assisted tech 3 factories very, very quickly when they need it. But we've got the megaliths on the move. We've got this guy down here. Have they got names? No, because these guys aren't pros, they don't have super annoying naming mods. They just got regular units. That's nice to see. So we've got one and two and... Whoa, it's nearly half completed because we've got a lot of assistance from all of the players here. That will be completed fairly soon. And the GC is actually done. There was a bit of assistance there from Pacoz to get that guy completed. Are they aware, though, that there are, in fact, a couple of megaliths waiting for them? Well, yes, they've got radar coverage, and they have got those guys scouted, so they can see there are two megaliths. I think Ish will be a little bit more reluctant to engage so quickly this time. He did feel that he had broken through the front lines, that he would be able to rampage all the way through to the back of the base with that GC, but it didn't happen. So he's going to move it up. It looks like he's just trying to get ready to intercept it a little bit more. Well, this is interesting. How many Percivals are there? There's about a dozen or so Percys. Now, that could be quite useful. A dozen Percys accompanying a GC, that could make a difference. But still, two megaliths, I think that's a little bit too much of an ask. As long as those megaliths are together. If they hit them one at a time, one megalith against both the Percys and GC, that would probably come out in Blodir's favor right now. We can see there's actually a few harbies just clearing out this around the left side of the mainland. And actually, this side has been really, really neglected. If those harbies clear out those tech 1 point defense and move on down, if they can get past the brick and any other just floating around defensive units, they can actually cause a little bit of damage, take out some eco, possibly even get back up into the base here, because there's only a few bricks standing between them and the main base of our master. Have we had an air engagement yet? No, we still haven't. These guys still just jostling for numbers, making sure they've got as many ASF as they can. Where are all Ish's ASF going? There we go. There's a little cloud of about a dozen or so there. That could make the difference, although everywhere is looking very, very healthy on ASF numbers right now. He's got a very substantial cloud, although both these guys looking pretty good. It'll come down to who has the best micro when it comes to the air game. All right, we've got the two Megaliths right side by side, and they're actually accompanied by a whole stack of Loyalists, which is a very, very nice plan, because if they can get those Loyalists up around the feet of the GC and continue stunning it, they'll manage to do exactly what they did to the last GC and stun it to death, effectively. The Megaliths moving towards that position now. These Harbingers, though, they're breaking through. The Bricks are a little bit slow. This guy really is walking the wrong direction. The Bricks are going to have a hard time catching those Harbingers. They're just so slow compared to the speedy little feats on those Harbies. So that's going to cause a little bit of damage here. It's going to take out some anti-air. It's going to take out a little bit of eco, just a little bit against our Master, who is sitting on 286, which is well out in front of everybody. We've got dropping down to 279, we've got 247 with everywhere, 235 with Ish in third place for eco production. It's your funeral on 130, and then the last two spots go to Hershey and Picoz, which are both on Blodir's team. So Blodir just maybe drawing a little bit of a short straw here and not having anyone that he can really rely on past Ish to get massive T3 ecos up and running. But this is a big stack of Percivals. Unfortunately, they're taking a lot of fire from those Megaliths at range before they can get their bolts away, and they're wasting them on Loyalists now. Oh, what is this? No, don't turn your Megalith to not face the enemy. The Megaliths are going to start taking Percy fire. There's enough Percy's there to get rid of all of those Loyalists and start laying fire down into the back of the Megaliths. They need to hurry up and dispatch that GC so that they can then get onto the Percy's. It looks like our Master may be just having a little bit of trouble with the micro of those two beasts right there, but he should be able to do the job down to 14k HP, dropping massively every time those bolts hit from the main guns on those Megaliths. But that first Megalith going down to all of the fire from all of the Harbingers and Percival. I don't think there's actually enough left. Our Master is probably going to lose it, and again, poor Micro, he leaves his rear exposed to the Percivals, and he's taking all of that fire. Oh, he just can't make up his mind about what he's going to shoot, and now he's shooting the Galactic Colossus over there while his Megalith dies. Oh. Mephi will be completely bald by now, surely, surely. Okay, so we just lost two Megaliths to the one GC, plus some Percivals. He didn't back those Megas up at all, and he lost them to the Percival and Harbinger fire. Very, very sad to see. It looks like they're thinking about forcing an air engagement here, but the numbers are very solidly with Blodir's team now. There are a lot of losses by the look of it, down to 55 ASF. And we'll compare that to Hershey's, well, exactly the same, but plus 10 out of fuel. The big difference will be that, well, Ish, what happened to your ASF? Did you lose them in the engagement? It looks like he probably did. So again, we're seeing very, very even numbers of ASF after Ish lost his contribution. But we do have a very nice stack of units rolling on down from the north. They are mostly Harbingers. They will die reasonably easily to any heavy Tech 3 land, but there is not, well, is there enough here? There are 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, yeah. There's probably enough bricks to deal with those guys in there. I think that'll probably work. What have we got? Another Megalith completed. Hopefully they can micro it a little bit better this time around. These bricks running face first into the Harbingers. How is this going to fare? How many bricks are left? Well, they're losing a couple. It looks like there's probably going to be the numbers, actually, because there's more Harbies following up, and I'm not quite sure what the plan is with these. So there's Tech 3 mobile artillery in the mix as well, but those guys are expensive and they're not very good in direct combat, so maybe not the best idea. The Bricks actually having to evac out the side, and the Harbingers now have free reign to clear this left-hand side once again. This is looking very, very dangerous for Mephi's team. This looked like it was going to go solidly in Mephi's favour, but losing those two Megaliths absolutely miserably, and leaving the reclaim on Isha and Hershey's doorstep. Absolutely critical mistake there from Mephi's team. They're trying to get up here and clear out those engineers with these bricks, but there's still five Percivals in there. That's easily going to be enough. And the next GC is online as well. So that is looking very, very bad for Mephi's team. All of a sudden, they have gifted so much mass across that it more than makes up for that GC mass gift that we saw from Ish earlier on. We have got some solace. Tech 3 torpedo bombers trying to deal with the pesky water units that our master has put together. There is a Tech 2 naval HQ, well, at least for a couple of seconds, there's a Tech 2 naval HQ. It did have a destroyer out that was trying to do a little bit of damage, but I think probably the direct fire nature, let's just zoom down here and see where these guys were sitting. That cliff makes it a little bit hard to get any work done. They really needed something with a high arcing fire, much more akin to cruisers. Right, the GC in the middle here is now working. It's about a third of its weight to its first veterancy. It's got a pretty decent amount of units and support, but for some reason, Ish decided to pull those guys back and not really finish us off. There's still a couple of Tech 2 mass extractors. It might have been this megalith that was on its way out fairly soon that managed to dissuade him. And in fact, there's another one here. So we're still talking about two megaliths. If only we could get some really good micro happening with those, they should be able to push through this GC and up into Ish's base. If they can clear Ish's base, that should be the end of it. But they've got to do it before this Tsar is completed, because that is so, well, that's only about 70% complete right now. That is really not that far off being completed. And if it is, they just need to knock out the ASF from the skies and they'll be able to win the game with that. We did have some restorers popping out here from Ish. He probably needs to focus a little bit more though on ASF right now, because they absolutely need to get that air control. If they can get that air control, that Tsar will finish the game. But if they don't, if they lose that Tsar to more ASF, they are going to be in big trouble, because they are outnumbered in ground experimentals right now. We've got three megaliths already up and running for Mephi's team. They've only got a single GC that is very, very badly outgunned by those megaliths. But all the Tsar is completed, or it is time for that air engagement. Now they desperately, desperately need to win that air. If they lose the air and leave just 20 or so ASF, they're gonna lose the Tsar and they are gonna lose the game. So now it's time to put all your ASF cards forward. We need to see, why are the ASF not moving? What's going on? What is everywhere doing? He's not even getting them ready to go. Do we have any ASF from any other players? No, it is just everywhere. And it looks like the Tsar is going directly for everywhere first. He's now mobilized his ASF. Does he have the numbers to do it? Oh, I'm not sure that he does. Who's going to get the best turn here? Well, both of them actually, looks like they've hit stop on their ASF and they're just swirling around and not trying to micro them as a clump. That is a bad, bad air loss for everywhere. That is a huge number of ASF still remaining for for Hershey, and that is going to be a big problem. He did lose about half of his HP, and that is why he lost the air so badly. He really needed to take down that Tsar in a single pass with his ASF. It didn't happen. And now, I don't see a way out of this for these guys. They are going to be absolutely screwed when that Tsar reaches it. That's a good question. How many SAMs have they got? There are four Transcenders already online. And there is a nuke launcher. It's about 80, 90% completed on the first nuke. They really need to take out those SAMs. Take out the SAMs, otherwise you're going to lose the Tsar on just taking out the nuke launcher. And it looks like he's gonna wait, grabbed a little bit of veterancy, but he's still only on 10k HP. He really needs to get rid of those SAM launchers. Is he gonna be able to do it? Yes, he got some more veterancy. Very, very nice pickup. Why everywhere didn't control get all of those engineers, I do not know, but a massive amount of veterancy, up to 30k HP on that Tsar now, and he is gonna absolutely wreck that base. that is going to be GG, because there is no coming back from that. They've lost all of their air. They lost the T3. Well, no, they didn't lose the T3 HQ. There is a support factory still online. He's going to come back, finish off those annoying SAMs. There we go. Nicely done. This is going to clear out the entire island, and there is absolutely nothing those guys can do about it. We have got now three megaliths trying to take on Ish's position. Ish is actually just sitting back and taking artillery fire on his GC, but I think they are probably pretty secure now. Ish is just going to park his ACU down here, make sure he can't get taken out by those megaliths. But Hershey is absolutely running away with the air game now. Well, actually, down into the red, 6,500 HP. He is now on full veterancy, so no more bumps for him. He needs to be able to take out those SAMs before he loses that SAR. Otherwise, it will just be a mass donation. But they have done an incredible amount of damage to the eco over here. They've taken out a lot of mass extractors, a lot of power, which is very, very important. There is no way that Mephi's team is going to be able to get back into the air game now. The air HQ is still online. Well, it was for just a second, and that is the end of it. I think there is no more. Well, actually, there are some ASF rolling out here from our master. He has managed to hurriedly put some together. They probably will be able to take that SAR down because it's only on 3,000 HP remaining. But still, the damage has been done. This entire island is almost void of structures for these guys. Is going to be very difficult for those ecos to come back. Let's look at those ecos. It's your funeral down to 117, everywhere down to 132, and our master, whoa, our master 560. Is that reclaim or is that just a ridiculous number of T3 mixes? That is eco whoring at its best. Well, 400 looks like it is a more accurate assessment. Right, the SAR, where did the SAR go? Oh, it didn't go down. They tried to bring it back for reclaim, but the ASFs did get to it and knock it out of the sky. So now we have the SAR gone, which actually would have been very, very handy at eliminating these megaliths, but that is not the case. We've got one GC remaining. We've got three very, very healthy looking megaliths. So it looks like Ish is going to be booted off this main island here, which is a bit of a problem for them. So they are retaining their side island, but they are not faring too well on this main island. This base over here has been almost completely eliminated for Pekoz. Hershey is not yet on the main island at all, but he is building a donut of his own, and that is embedded in the cliff. Well, okay, if the game says you've got room, then you've got room, even if it is inside a cliff. But if he can complete that, that will be able to deal to these megaliths, and it actually makes it a little bit hard for Mephi's team to assault these guys. They would need to either do drops or use air power to get across and do some real damage here. They don't really have either of those options at the moment because of the lack of air control. Well, actually, lack of air control. Where are all the ASF? What happened to the ASF? Are they hiding, or are there only two left? What is going on here? Hershey's managed to, while he was microing his SAR, managed to lose all of his ASF. Okay, so that actually puts our master in a good position for air. So that actually does open up some opportunities to use airstrikes to reach out and touch this island. That SAR, how is that going? How is the eco for Hershey looking? Well, he is very, very badly stalled on mass. He's not actually getting any assistance from his teammates either. So that badly stalled mass, which is going into that SAR, that'll take a few minutes for it to complete. But meanwhile, Hershey has been, well, Ish, sorry, has been completely knocked off the island. Fortunately for Blodir's team, they did take out that nuke. It was about 90% complete, and they took it down. That was very lucky. We've got some, wow, it looks like Pekoz is just going to hole up back in his base and just defend like a mofo, because he is putting down ravages. He has got a fat boy sitting there. It's actually going to be reasonably difficult for those megaliths to get close. The mobile artillery are going to sit back and pepper the base. They've got a T3 heavy shield though. That's going to last a reasonable amount of time. And that fat boy fire should be able to deal with those artillery in reasonable order, I would think. But still, three megaliths and nowhere to back up. The real strength of the fat boy is when you can back on up and kite your enemy. but there is just nowhere for him to go. Those megaliths have got more than enough HP to tank the fat boy fire until they get into its face and just demolish it. The real difference will be these ravagers. How many are there? There's 6, 9, 10 ravagers and a couple more back here. We've got a dozen or so ravagers. That is a heck of a lot of alpha damage. If you can keep those guys alive and not lose them to the demolished, trebuchets, aren't they, because they're cybern, the trebuchet fire, if he could keep them alive, they would do fantastically well, but they are almost all gone. The fat boy shield is gone. Those bolts from the megaliths absolutely ripping through the hull, and down goes the fat boy. So now the view from atop the megalith is a pretty undefended base for Pecoz. So this is going to spell trouble. These guys have lost their air control. So Blodir's team, no more air control. There's a lot of T3 mobile AA as well. They have lost pretty much the entire main island. They are running out of resources very quick. Our master sitting on 5779, that was reclaimed, 463 though. Still, that is a heck of a lot of income to be able to pump out experimentals. All they need to do now is take out that Tsar, and it'll swing back purely in Mephi's favor, and it's going to be absolutely impossible for these guys to come back. We've got the two megaliths now just cleaning up Pecoz's base. And oh, what is this? The unfriendly teammates did not give Pecoz a transport to get his ACU out of there. So he is now under megalith fire. He's going to last approximately one more second. And boom, he is gone. So Pecoz has been formally ejected from the game. Our masters ASF are absolutely ripping that Tsar to shreds. It is going to go down very, very quickly, and that is the end of that. Hershey, was he down in the water there and got taken out by the megalith? That might have been the case. In any case, it didn't make too much difference at this point. Ish did manage to get back up onto the island, but still, there's no point in even trying. Wow! Okay, so that was a 47-minute game in which Mephi's anus did manage to dislodge Blodir. Well, let's just have a quick look at the thing. Blodir is what? Stack wizards. Not so stacked or not so wizardy either. Oh dear. Alright, so there we have Blodir getting taken apart by Mephi. Mephi, of course, was the 2016 world champion, so he does know a couple of things about the game. He managed to bring his team back from the brink of destruction and take out the win.